forth to you. With our nation struggling to get along, I thought today, as a gift from the scripture on our nation's birthday, that we would look at how to love people, whether they're online or in the work cubicle next to you or in the trailer park down the street from you. And to do that, let's look at Luke's Gospel, the 19th chapter. He entered Jericho and was passing through. And there was a man named Zacchaeus. He was the chief collector of taxes, and he was very rich. He was seeking to see who Jesus was, but on account of the crowd, he could not, because he was small of stature. So he ran on ahead and climbed up into the sycamore tree to see Jesus, for he was about to pass that way. When Jesus came to the place, he looked up and said to him, "Zacchaeus, hurry and come down. I must stay at your house today." So he hurried and came down and received him joyfully. And when they saw it, they all grumbled, "He's gone in to be the guest of a man who is a sinner." And Zacchaeus stood up after the supper and said, "Lord, behold, the half of my goods I give to the poor. And if I've defrauded anyone of anything, I restore it fourfold." And Jesus said to him, "Today, salvation has come to this house, since he also is the son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost." Let us pray. Lord, show us what this passage means and what it is in these difficult national days to love other people. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. My first ministry was 100 miles north of here in a tiny little village of about 500 people called Charlotte Courthouse, Virginia, the old village church there. And I used to go into work at 8 o'clock in the morning, mainly because people thought ministers are lazy. I've had so many people say it must be nice to work 9 to 5. And one of my divinity professors taught me, go into work at 8. They won't be able to use that on you. So I would walk to work at 8 so my wife could have our only car in the morning. And then I would walk home for lunch and use the car in the afternoon. But somewhere mid-morning, after a couple hours of study, I would walk across the street to a service station and get a cold drink and a cookie. And there was no place to sit except on the wall out in front of the courthouse. And there were always a row of Charlotte County geezers sitting there, pontificating about inflation or war or the state of the country. And I would sit there among them and listen to them. One time I was sitting there taking a bite of my cookie and drinking my drink, and this traveling sales rep from Northern Virginia came through selling his wares. And he stopped to fill his tank up there, and he looked around, and he took a deep breath, and he said, "Wow," he said, "fresh air, sunshine. Do you know there's not a single stoplight in all of Charlotte County, Virginia," which is still true. And he said, "You sure don't have much of a population problem here." And one of the old geezers sitting beside me looked at him and says, "Boy, let me explain it to you. Dang near every problem we got around here is caused by the population. If you look in the world today, you see that we do have a population problem. In fact, my favorite theologian, Reinhold Niebuhr, put it this way in his book, The Nature and Destiny of Man. Man's greatest problem, Niebuhr wrote, man's greatest problem is man himself. Divorce, abortion, racism, hatred, terrorism, war. I was doing a wedding in Boston a few summers ago, and one of the ushers had on his naval officer's uniform, and I recognized the submariner's pin on his uniform, and I said, you're a commander of a sub? And he said, I am. He said, my boat is down at Groton. He said, you passed through there on the way home. You want a tour? And I said, well, I've got my two sons with me. And he said, that's all right. Come spend the night in my apartment. I'm a single man, and I'll give you a tour of a nuclear submarine. So 2 days later, we were there. Now, they don't make submarines for people my size. I bumped my head. You've been on a sub, huh? Yeah. Tiniest thing I've ever been on. They showed us a lot of the submarine. But I learned something that day that I wish I didn't know. A boomer, a Trident nuclear submarine, carries 5,000 times more firepower than all the munitions expended in World War II put together. Let that sink in. 5,000 times more firepower. It's incredible the ability we have to destroy as human beings. Now, all of this is old as sin. Do you remember the first relationship in the Bible? It was between Adam and Eve. And what did Adam do when God first brought Eve to him? He broke from prose and spoke poetry to her, the oldest poem in human literature. Bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh, you shall be called woman because you were taken from the man. But that poetry in the relationship didn't last. When Adam and Eve sinned, they began to bicker. Do you remember? He blamed his wife to God for the sin. The woman whom thou gavest to be with me, she gave me the fruit and I ate. And you know, the children of Adam and Eve picked up on their bickering. And the first homicide in Scripture was when Cain murdered his own brother, Abel. Then you come to the second oldest poem in human literature in Genesis chapter 4. Lamech writes a poem of braggadocious homicide. This man struck me, he said, and I killed him. He bumped into me, and I put him down. And it's a man bragging to anybody who will listen that he murdered another man. And you get a really chilling picture of human relationships and what sin has done to us in the Scripture. Now, where is the cure? In the great commandment, we're told to love our neighbor. And the beauty of the Bible is it doesn't just tell us what to do, it shows us how to do it. And this is the mystery of Jesus' incarnation. He didn't come to talk about love to us. He came to demonstrate how to do it. Now, what I'm going to teach you is called relational theology. It's not taught in the Bible, but it's rather demonstrated in the Bible. Jesus never said, do it in these four ways. But he showed us in these four ways how to do it. So let's turn this text into a baseball diamond if we can. You know, first base, second base, third base, home plate. In loving his neighbor, Jesus first went to first base with another human being. He gathered information or knowledge about that other person. I call this data collection. What did he learn about Zacchaeus in the text? That Zacchaeus was short. He was very unpopular as a tax collector. He was spiritually hungry. Though he was very rich, the money wasn't enough. He was spiritually hungry. And he was wanting to see who Jesus was, but because of the shortness of his stature, he couldn't see over the shoulders of the crowd. Because he was unpopular, there were a lot of elbows pushing him to the back of the crowd. So what does Zacchaeus do? He's so overpowered by his spiritual hunger that he runs ahead to a place where he's sure Jesus will pass, and he climbs up a sycamore tree. And here Jesus is bumping along on a donkey. And he comes to this sycamore tree, and there's Zacchaeus, this quizzical little Jewish face, about 20 feet above him, pushing the limbs back, looking down at Jesus. I would love to see this in film. I would love to have been there in person. So the first step of learning how to love somebody is to find out who they are, to gather information about him. Now, Jesus had intrinsic wisdom to do this. Intrinsic wisdom means that Jesus could just look into your face and read it. Have you ever been able to do that? Sometimes the Holy Spirit visits that gift on us today. You can look in a person's face and see broken commandments all over it. And you don't really need to ask them too much about themselves. You know the mystery of rejection, hatred, and heartache. Well, Jesus had intrinsic wisdom. Remember with the woman at the well, he said, go call your husband. And she said, I'm not married. And Jesus said, you have been honest with me in that you're not married, but you've lived with 5 other men, and you're living with a man now. How's it going? And remember this woman ran into the city and said, come meet a man who told me everything about myself. Or do you remember Jesus when he called Nathanael as a disciple? He said, you're a Hebrew in whom there's no guile. And he said, how do you know these things about me? And Jesus said, when you were under the tree, the broom tree, I saw you and I knew you even before we met. Now, we don't have intrinsic wisdom generally, but God has gifted us with 2 eyes, 2 ears, and 1 mouth, which tells you something of the proportionality between listening and speaking that we should do as human beings. We should observe. We should ask questions. We should listen twice as much as we talk and probe people. Who are you? Tell me your life story. What makes you tick? I was preaching in Albany, New York a couple of summers ago. The morning platform speaker at a Fellowship of Christian Athletes convention up on Lake George, New York. And when I got there, they said, would you mind doing a marriage conference at night as well? Some of our coaches have requested that. So I was doing double duty. And by the end of the week, I was tired. And the taxi took me from Lake George back to the airport at Albany. And I decided I was going to sleep on the plane going home. The Lord had other plans. There was this elderly woman sitting beside me. And when I sat down and buckled in, she looked at me and smiled with these ancient blue eyes. And she said, I hope it's not going to rain in Baltimore. And I wanted to say, madam, I don't care what it's doing in Baltimore. I'm going to have a snooze, and you're going to leave me alone. Well, I smiled at her and said, well, I hope the weather will be pleasant, too. And so I kind of shut my eyes and leaned back and tried to ease off. And she elbowed me again and said, oh, I really do hope it's not going to be raining in Baltimore. And I said, lady, why do you care what the weather's doing in Baltimore? Oh, my late husband Herb died of cancer last night. His body is in a casket in the belly of the plane, and we're flying him to Baltimore today for the funeral. And some of my friends who are still alive are going to meet me at the cemetery, and we're going to have his funeral. And I really hope it doesn't rain in Baltimore. Well, as tired as you might be, it's time to listen, isn't it? And I remember saying, tell me about your husband. And she had been nursing him for 6 years, a slow death of cancer. And now she was feeling her grief and carrying her husband of 49 years to Baltimore to be interred. A gentleman in the seat behind her heard the conversation and entered in. And when the plane landed, we walked her to a taxi cab. And as we shut the door, what do you think she said to the driver? Oh, I do hope it's not going to be raining in Baltimore today. And as I was walking back to my seat, I just remember praying, oh, Lord, help him to listen. Help him to listen. The first step of loving your neighbor is not to judge them or to give them your opinion or to spell out your theology or even necessarily to share Jesus with them. But it's to incarnate yourself in their life in that moment in a plane seat or at a cafe or while you're walking or just sitting as a friend in the shade, and to enter their world and listen to them and find out who they are and where they are and what makes them tick. Now, once a person opens up and reveals something of who they are and who they aren't, there's a kind of awkward moment. Are they going to reject me? Do they think my mustache looks funny? Do they notice my hickey accent? And we're kind of nonplussed. Are they going to accept me or reject me? So the second step Jesus took in loving his neighbor was to affirm them. How did Jesus affirm Zacchaeus? Zacchaeus, come down. I must have supper at your house today. Boy, can you imagine that bandy little Jewish man just coming down that tree like a squirrel and sticking his chest out and walking beside Jesus and saying, it's this way, Lord. It's only a quarter of a mile. This way. I've got something good you'll enjoy. And all the rest of the people were mumbling, who is this Jewish man that gets to entertain the Messiah? What a fortunate guy he is. I used to be a pastor in Wilmington, North Carolina. And you know who's from Wilmington? Michael Jordan. They named the interstate there coming in, the Michael Jordan Expressway. Laney High School there on the right as you come into Wilmington is where he played his first basketball. And when I was there, Jordan was finishing up his NBA career, and he bought the Washington Wizards, and he was both coaching and playing for them. Now, in the summer, he would bring the Wizards down to Wilmington, to UNCW, and they would practice there, getting ready for the opening game. And the hottest ticket in town was to get a ticket to see Michael Jordan Wizards play a scrimmage game. It was a sellout. Now, imagine that you imagined for $40 to get one of the few tickets that was available. And you were sitting way up in the nosebleed section, and you were watching Michael Jordan play what was some of his last basketball. You were watching history there. And halftime came, and his team ran off the court to go in the locker room. But Michael Jordan stopped, and he looked up at you, and he pointed like this, and you said, me? And he said, yeah. And you didn't know what to do. And he came running up three steps at a time with those big long legs, and he knelt down in front of you, and he said, Charles, don't rush off after the game. Let's go get something to eat together and catch up. And then he went back down into the locker room. Wouldn't that be an incredible experience to have? Michael Jordan knew your name, and he wanted to eat lunch with you. That's something of what you get in this text when Jesus said, Zacchaeus, I know your name, and I know where your house is, and I want to go to your house and have lunch with you. When I don't have a lot to do, I like to people watch. And one of the best places to do it is right down the street at where? At Home Depot. Or at Walmart. And have you ever watched how people correct their children in Home Depot or Walmart? There's this mother that's putting things in the basket, and the son looks at it, little four-year-old, and he doesn't like it. And when she's not looking, he throws it back on the shelf. And he'll grab some brownie mix and put it in there, and she'll take it and put it back. He's pitching a fit. And the mother keeps correcting him less and less gently each time. And after about the sixth time, she just grabs him by the arm and jerks him up. I don't know how she doesn't dislocate his shoulder. And she slams him down and says, you're bad. You're bad. I'm sorry I had you. And when your daddy gets home and I get you home to him, he's going to beat the tarnation out of you. Now, how would you like to grow up in a home with 18 years of that? Now, go just across the town to the local ball field and watch people there. And you get a little six-year-old who's trying to play ball. Swing, miss, swing, miss. I mean, this is like watching grass grow or paint dry. It is the most boring Little League game in the world. Nothing ever happens. But finally, there's a clang of a bat hitting a ball, and everybody looks up, and to their surprise, a ball goes sailing over the shortstops out into the outfield. And the little kid there is standing on home plate, holding the bat over his head, jumping up and down, celebrating. He didn't know to run to first base. And his father, who's sitting in the bleacher below you, starts cheering him and saying, "Run, son, you got to run. You got to do it. Make it happen. Run." And the kid looks at his father and anxious to please him, but not knowing what to do, he runs out and tackles the pitcher. The kid's in the wrong game. And what does the father do? "That's my boy. He can hit. He can tackle. He's going to make a great baseball player with that tackle, don't you think?" Wouldn't you love to grow up in a home with a father with a sense of humor like that? Who doesn't say, "What are you, stupid son? You're supposed to run." You can really look around and see people's ability to affirm others or their unwillingness or inability to do it. One of my favorite Bible verses is in Philippians, the 4th chapter. "Whatsoever things are good, whatsoever things are noble, if there is anything worthy of praise, think upon these things." Now, God has given you a wonderful ability to compliment people for the excellence in their life. You can smile. You can shake their hand. You can listen. You can offer a helping hand. You can share a meal with them. You can compliment them in some way. And it's a wonderful gift to be able to do that. Now, when you take time to listen to people and get to know them, and when they reveal something of who they are to you, and you affirm them, you begin to build trust. And the person says, "I feel safe with this person. I show them a little of who I am, and they don't reject me or mock me or make a joke, but instead they affirm me, and I trust this person." And that's when you can go to third base with the person, and that's begin to deal with the problems in their life. What was Zacchaeus' problem? He was materialistic. He was a tax collector who unscrupulously overtaxed the people and made himself rich and left them that much the poorer. He was very unpopular, a lot of rejection in his life. He was spiritually hungry. The world is not enough. He wanted to know who Jesus was, but he was short and pretty much friendless. You remember the fairy tale of your youth where the wicked witch turned a handsome prince into a green, slimy, warty, burpy bullfrog? And you remember she said, "You'll never be a handsome prince again," until a beautiful princess comes along and kisses you on your slimy, warty lips. And off hops the bullfrog prince to sit on a lily pad and bewail his fate, croak it to the livelong day and night. "What chance is there a beautiful princess is ever going to love me?" But do you remember in the fairy tale, one day just that very thing happens? A beautiful princess comes along and sees the tiny crown on his head, and looking beyond all the ugly and the warts, kisses him on those warty lips. And slowly all the ugly falls away, and the handsome prince is restored. There's a bit of the gospel of Jesus Christ in that, isn't it? People have all kinds of problems in the world today. They're misguided. Their lifestyle is delusional. They're lonely. They're broke. They're bitter. They're just coming back from the divorce lawyer. They're getting over a nervous breakdown. They've lost their job. I was asked to preach in a church nearby about 4 years ago when there was a flu epidemic going through. And the church was very poorly attended. And the elder stood up before the service and said, "Due to the pandemic, we're not going to touch each other today. And we want everybody to sit 10 feet apart. And I'm not going to shake hands at the door after church. We're just going to listen to the sermon and leave. There'll be no singing." And I thought, gee, this is going to be a bummer. And we did just that. And this church was struggling. It was clearly a dying church. Well, that same week, I went to Duke University, flu epidemic there. And I was ministering with Campus Crusade for Christ. And they'd been struggling to get it going again. It had been going well in the 70s and 80s, but it had been going poorly the last decade. And they were trying to get it going. And there were just six people there. But these crusade people were hugging each other. They were shaking hands. And they had a conversation in response to the teaching. What can we do to reach out to the campus? And they said, you know, a lot of people are really suffering with the flu. We could take their lessons plans to them from the professors. We could type their papers and take the papers to the professors. So even though they're too sick to leave the room, we can help. We can take them chicken soup. We can see if they need anything, toilet paper, toothpaste or whatever. And so these six students decided they would do that. Four of the students got the flu. Two of them escaped it. But the next time I went back to that meeting, there were 30 people there. And some months later, I went back, there were over 200. And the place that the ministry on Duke's campus got traction was when people came out of their fearful stained glass foxholes and started ministering to students in need. And that's what you find Jesus doing in the text. He gets to first base with Zacchaeus. Who are you? Short, tax collector, spiritually hungry, unpopular, running on ahead to climb a tree. He affirms him. Come down, I must have supper at your house today. And then he begins to get involved in the problems of Zacchaeus' life. I'm sure they had a conversation, though the text doesn't share the details, about materialism and what it's like to climb the ladder to success in the material world, only to find that ladder leaning against a very lonely wall with not much of a view. And Jesus talked to him about the rightful place of money, the compassionate use of money in a wealthy person's life. Now, Jesus moved on to the final base, that's home plate, or fourth base, with goal setting. Do you remember what Zacchaeus did after supper? He stood up and in response to Christ, he said, behold, the half of my wealth I give to the poor. That was a big change. And if I've defrauded anybody, I'm going to restore everything I took. Four times the amount I took. Boy, don't you know he was the talk of the town? When conversion gets down in a person's pocketbook like that, that's really evidence of an exciting conversion, isn't it? In fact, giving or generosity is the economic evidence that we've been born again. And Zacchaeus begins to exhibit that evidence. Now, to show you that this is not just an aberration of Scripture, in the relationships that you see Jesus living throughout the New Testament, he follows these four steps. Do you remember Legion? Living alone in a cemetery, demon-possessed, that's data. Do you remember Christ got in a boat and got out of the boat, and when the man threw himself at his feet, Jesus asked him, what is your name? Do you see the data, the affirmation there? The demons in him said, don't hurt me, don't hurt me. Send us into the pigs. And Christ did that. But then do you remember that Legion tried to set a goal? I want to go with you, Lord. And Christ said, no, here's the better goal. Go home to your friends. Tell them there how much the Lord has done for you, how he's had mercy upon you. Or look at the woman caught in the act of adultery. This is not rocket science, data. There's a woman. She's caught in the act of adultery. The men want to bash her skull in. Jesus doesn't pick up a rock. Instead, he handles the men. It's where he wrote in the dirt at their feet. We know Jesus could write. This is one of the only places in the Bible that Jesus ever wrote anything. I imagine in front of this man, he wrote his mistress's girlfriend's name. Over here, he wrote the exact sum of money that this wealthy banker had embezzled that day from the funds. Over here, he mentioned something else just by writing it in the dirt. And one by one, the men stirred the dirt so it was illegible, dropped their stone, and disappeared. And Jesus said, "Woman, where are your accusers?" And she said, "They are not, Lord." And he said, "Good. You're free now to go." And what was the goal? Sin no more. You see, in story after story, he runs the bases with these people. Now, Jesus didn't knock a home run with everybody that he tried to love. Do you remember the rich young ruler? He was rich, he was young, he was a ruler. There's your data. And Jesus looked upon him and loved him, the text said. There's your affirmation. And the kid said to him, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" You remember Christ said, "Go home and you have great wealth. Give it away to the poor. Put your trust in the Lord. Let him take care of you." And do you remember at this saying, the man's countenance fell and he walked away sorrowfully, for he had great wealth? Jesus didn't get to all four bases with everybody he tried to run them with. But with this man Zacchaeus, he did. You ever notice when you go to a doctor, you almost always come out with a prescription in your hand? There's something wrong. Here are some goals you need to take. This pill twice a day, morning and night. Get you some exercise. Don't drink alcohol on this pill. And take a long walk each day. See if you can drop about 30 pounds. We get a prescription, don't we? And Jesus, in setting goals with people, often gave them prescription. Go home and tell them there. The half of my wealth I give to the poor. You can see these goals coming out in Scripture, and it's wonderful to see. When I was a young pastor in Charlotte Courthouse, Virginia, Margaret played the piano for us, and Margaret was an alcoholic. In fact, of the four elders in that church, all four elders' wives and one of the elders were alcoholics. That's what you get when you get out of seminary and go to a weak church, a lukewarm church, and the country's full of them. And part of the ministry is reviving churches like that. Margaret, one of the elders' wives, was an alcoholic, but she played the organ. And she generally played it very well. Well, I had a two-church charge there, one in Drake's Branch, Virginia, that I would preach at 9 to 10. Then I would jump in the car and drive to Charlotte Courthouse, and the other service would begin at 11. And the only elder that would come pray with me before the service was David, the organist's husband, who was an elder. And this particular Sunday, he was distracted. In fact, he was angry and sad-looking. And it was 5 minutes to 11, so I didn't have time to say, "What's troubling you, David?" So we prayed. I went out and sat in the big chair with my robe on and my stole, you know, looking very ecclesiastical. And Margaret is playing the prelude. Now, I'm not a musician, but I realized that music's not quite right. And I look over there at Margaret, and she is so inebriated, she's drooling and leaning over the keys like this. And the prelude is just a slur of music that's all out of order. And I look back from Margaret with astonishment, and I looked out at David, her husband, that should be doing something about this, and David was sitting there like this. And I looked away from David to the face of the people. They were sitting there like this. "Mm-hmm. Yeah, fresh out of divinity school in Atlanta. Oh, we're sure glad you're our pastor. I'm sure you've had a course in divinity school and how to deal with events like this. We're watching to see how you're going to handle it, preacher." That was the look on their face. Well, I'm from the South. My first instinct was to be a gentleman, just to get up and walk over with aplomb and say, "Now, dear Margaret, this is not a day for you to be playing the organ. You're not well. David, come get your wife, and let's get you home and get some coffee in you, and we'll muddle through, and we'll talk about this later." And I was getting ready to do that, and I saw Margaret's purse sitting up on top of the organ. And I knew that Margaret, when she was drinking, was a mean drunk. And I could see her grabbing that purse. I'm not going home. I'm playing the music. And she'd beat me with that purse in front of the whole congregation. A little voice in the back of my head said, "Don't do it, Kratz." So you know what I did? I just stood up and pretended that Margaret was fine and the music was okay, and I doubled the enthusiasm. Boy, welcome this morning. When we sing this opening hymn, "A Mighty Fortress Is Our God," let's raise the rafters. Let's just overwhelm the organ with our voices. Country churches don't always sing very well, but that Sunday, they sang beautifully. Margaret played her song, which is way off. We actually did pretty good with "A Mighty Fortress" on our key, and we got through the whole service. Now, we did have a few visitors that day that were kind of wild-eyed and their mouths open, looking like, "What kind of funky, charismatic, tongue-speaking church is this? Something is going on here, and I don't fully understand it, but it bears questioning." Anyway, after the service was over, David got his wife, and they got in the car, and they went home, and they were just so embarrassed. The children were there, the grandkids, they were so embarrassed. The church was embarrassed for her. And the conversation became, what should we do? And goal setting came up. We gather data about Margaret. We know her issue. We affirm her and try not to embarrass her in public. And we've tried to intervene in this problem many times and gotten nowhere. But it's time for an alcoholic intervention. And that next night, 15 people from the church, myself included, were sitting in Margaret's living room. And we went around the group, and "I love you, Margaret. I have so many good memories with you. But Margaret, you were way out of line Sunday. You embarrassed your children, your grandchildren, your husband, yourself, the church, the Lord. Margaret, you need help. There's a problem, and you can't handle this alone." And afterwards, she agreed to go to a sanatorium, and they dried her out. And I was back up there preaching just before Margaret passed away about 2 years ago. She had quit playing the organ. A younger person was playing it. She was well into her 90s. She was sober. She was newly widowed. Her husband had passed away. But she was there on the pew, a beautiful, abiding woman of faith who had come through deep waters. Well, some household chores I want to look at before we try to draw this to a conclusion. In baseball, when you get a hit, you don't run to third base or you're out. You understand that you have to run the bases in order. And when you love somebody, you have to run the bases in order too. We tend today on the internet to want to get in somebody's face and say, "You're wrong, you're stupid." And sometimes we, instead of affirm them, we just say, "You got a problem and your brain must be stupid to believe that sort of thing." And we just go straight to third base. They reject us, unfriend us. It becomes typical internet. Or sometimes when we have a marital quarrel, we want to go straight for the juggler and say, "You mistreated me wrong. You've got a problem." My wife has been a little difficult to live with this week, and I was a little slow to remember why. Catherine has cancer, and she's finished 6 treatments and a surgery, and the 5th of July, she goes to a doctor for him to read her x-rays and tell her, "You're cancer-free," or "You still have it. We failed, and you probably have less than a year to live." And this had been working on her, and I wasn't sensitive enough to know it. And we had several quarrels. And finally, at supper one night, she said, "Thank you for your patience with me. I'm just really overwhelmed with apprehension and my emotions right now, and I can't really talk about it." And I felt like such a failure. But we need to run these bases in our marriages. Gather data. How are you feeling today? What are you expecting to hear from your doctor? I hope you have a long life because I can't imagine it without you. What can I do to help soothe your anxieties? Let's set some goals together for what we're going to do once we get the verdict from the cancer specialist. I'm expecting good news, and I think that's what she dearly hopes for too. But you see how important these are in your marriage? They're also important in how you rear children. To sit down with a teenager that slams the door in your face and say, what's going on in your life? Boy, have I ever told you lately how proud I am to be your dad? You seem like you're struggling lately, and it turns out to be a teacher at school that's making fun of them, and they're making bad grades, and you find out about that, and you set some goals, maybe some tutoring, or look at their study habits, or go have a teacher-parent conversation with the student there. These techniques are great for marriages, for rearing children. You can use them internationally with political relations with other nations, but you can also use them with individuals. There's a Peanuts comic strip that I dearly love. You remember Lucy is in love with Schroeder, who's always playing the piano? And Schroeder's sitting down playing Mozart, and the notes are flying off, and Lucy's just sitting there gaga at him. And finally, when he takes a break, she says, Schroeder, do you know what love is? And Schroeder stops and says, love is an outward inexpressibility of an inward all-overishness. It's a choice to act in the other person's best interest. And then he sits down and resumes his concert. And you remember Lucy looks at the comic strip reader and says, gee, on paper, isn't Schroeder just great? And I would say that about the Christian church. On paper, we are taught very clearly what it means to love your neighbor, to be incarnate in the world, inquisitive and gather data about people, to find a way to affirm them, to meddle in their problems, and to set goals. Maybe you need to repent of your sins and put your trust in Christ. Join a good teaching church. Change your lifestyle to one of a Christian. This is the gospel of Jesus Christ. And on paper, it's wonderful. Our challenge is to get it off paper, wrap our flesh around it, and go into this ugly world and live it. Would you pray with me? Lord, we thank you. We thank you for the story of Zacchaeus. We thank you for the simple meaning of it and these wonderful steps you took and how you handled people and dealt with them and revealed your love. Etch these points, Lord, in our minds and hearts, and let us look at our relationships and see where we need to listen more, to affirm, to intervene with quoting the scriptures or calling for some goals. Teach us to do this as parents, as citizens, on the web, with the people we work with, the people who work for us, with our boss, with even other nations of the world. We ask this in Christ's name. Amen. The Lord be with you.